Michelle, I have great admiration for Michelle, how she is both, has a great artist practice as well as being a professor at Ontario College of Art and Design. She's very active in the community, and she has most recently had a studio award at Open Studio for the last year. And I think the work you're looking at here on exhibition are works that she, that were engaged in her studio at Open Studio. So, Michelle, over to you.
Yes, I think I'll stand up because I can project a little bit better that way. Thank you.
So I'm just so pleased that you're here, and I'm delighted to have this exhibition with you. It's a great moment, and we're thrilled to have you as part of our gallery, really.
Thank you.
So thank you, and please tell us about, I think I'm gonna just let you talk rather than ask you questions because you're a professor and you're always, you know what to say.
Yes, and I've been with Jane for over a year now, and I'm really excited to have the work in this space because it is a really fabulous space. And I work in the this side of my apartment, so my studio and my apartment are often intertwined, and the things that I do are often influenced by just general kind of living and upkeep of my life. Also, because I have Parkinson's, I have troubles moving around. So moving to a studio or whatever would be difficult for me, particularly now. So I thought I'd just start by talking a little bit about my background. My mother is from Oslo. And so at a very young age, you know, she taught me how to knit, and I always had all my sweaters knit and my clothing made and hats knitted and stuff like that. And at the time, you know, I thought to myself as the nerd kid whose mother made their clothes, but later proved to be something that really influenced my work. Because in these pieces, I make pretty much everything that you see, with some exceptions. So I guess the little ones are the oldest pieces, and those I did, I made the contents for those in Iceland on a residency at the textile center. And I had access to a knitting machine there, and I did a bunch of knitting on that. And these pieces were actually made for a store called Annie M to kind of blend in with their clothes, which is, they sell St. James and that kind of thing. And that's when I first kind of moved to Toronto. I've lived in Toronto for about 8 years now, and I was in the States for a while before that. If anybody has any questions as we go, feel free to just interrupt me and ask.
I'm going to jump in for a minute, okay?
Yes.
So Michelle was teaching in the States, and then I would have to say she came back to Toronto because she got a wonderful offer from OCAD to be a professor here. And so we're really delighted that they got you back here. But I would just say, so that you understand the practice a little, when you see the sculptures over here, you can see that Michelle talks about knitting, and she talks about sewing and all the various things that she does. So Michelle builds all these sculptures. You might think this is cloth, but if you feel this, this is actually cast aluminum that she paints. So she's making sculpture, and she's making cloth, and she's painting cloth, and she makes a paper to look like cloth, or she makes a bracelet to look like a skirt. But mostly, that all of these, she built the sculpture, and then she photographs them, and some of them are screened, some of them have paint on top, some of them have screen on top, but the practice is multimedia because there's so many different layers before she gets to this final product.
Yes.
Here's Magdalena. And I think what's interesting is to see in her practice how she builds so many layers, how she builds the sculpture, and how she's thinking about a cloth and then painting a tabletop the same as the cloth. And then when you think about clothes that Michelle has been talking about, and you can see some of the patterns and the clothes are the same, but you did mention that you had Parkinson, and I think in the last 10 years, as the progression of your disease changed your mobility, you had to change your practice to deal with the mobility, and the clothes have to do with how Michelle, with someone who is interested in fashion and is interested in textiles and texture, how she had to change her clothes to accommodate her decreased mobility.
Yes.
That's right, basically.
And another thing I want to say is when I build these photographs, I think of the photographs as kind of multiple possible endpoints to my practice, because although the photographs exist in here, my practice is one of more aligned with the craft process. And these bundles that are in all of the works actually start with either clothing I can't put on anymore due to the fact they have zippers or buttons, or simply that they don't fit onto my body. So they become kind of like this receptacle or skinning off of my old self in a certain way. But inside of them, they contain these notes that I keep secret. In the sense for, like when you go to a therapist or something and they say, bring it out. Well, I do the opposite, I pack it way down. Like, because if I brought that out, I'd probably never stop crying. So I think of all my works as kind of like building up a layer of protective skins on top of that, so that I can remain happy.
And they're really beautifully happy works. I mean, it's interesting you say that your color choices are vibrant, the colors you put next to one another, even the building up of different kinds of, if you look at that one on the far left, you have so many different textures and different textiles and color, and yet it comes together in a way here. You don't actually know which things are in the front and which are behind it. You have an odd sense of scale, isn't it? An odd sense of scale,
yes.
When you look at the flat works. But these are actually, Michelle, acting in the works.
Yes.
And
I should talk about those. Maybe I'll come over here to the clothing. So Jane said that I was been working at Open Studio. And at Open Studio, what I've been doing
go in front of her quickly.
Is I've been painting films. And the films, these are two of the new pieces of clothing that I made. But I've been painting these films onto frosted mylar of these patterns. They look like they're repeated, but actually they're not. This piece here is one hand-painted piece. This one's printed in reverse. So I take the film and flip it upside down. But it's not a repeat pattern in the typical sense that you would make cloth. So what I'm doing is, because I'm sewing them all myself, you know, I make the piece with the dart in it in as a hand-painted piece of film, and then I expose that to a screen and screen print on the cloth.
So tell us about, I mean, I think this one is really fun. And obviously, you put on your skirt that you made. I can see.
They're pants, actually.
Oh, they're pants. I can see that you have a little zipper that you made.
Yeah, here, I'm going to show them.
That you can actually pull the, I'm going to hold it.
Yeah, so even the inside of the hanger has got,
look at, like everything.
And then, they've got these great pockets in them.
And this is painted, so on this cloth.
It's screen printed.
Oh, that's screen painted? So beautiful.
Well, it's done in acrylic screen printing. Okay. Yeah, but we have to look at this out. Yeah.
Okay, so this is, here you're wearing the pants. You've obviously made some tights. You always have on some really beautiful tights and that nice texture, nice design. So you, did you make these as well?
No, the socks are not made. This, so the new works, because I need them, I have to have a friend come over and help me photograph them or go over to a friend's place. And my friend Nicola Feldman, because she helped me shoot these. She's a photographer in town. And they were her socks. She said, you need socks on them. So anyway, the backdrops are all hand-painted on Mylar. And this one's interesting because it's kind of disorienting. Like, you can't really tell where the corner of the wall is because this is the wall. And then it comes out here on the floor. But it seems to flatten out.
It flattens out, and then I can see your fingers here, which I think is really funny, because that
yeah,
one
you
has
can
a
see
flat,
arm here.
And that one has your fingers, which is kind of fun. So it kind of looks like you threw yourself up in the air there.
Yes, but I'm on my back, like.
And then this one has, you made the sculpture, and I can see you have your sculpture stand that you painted, and the variety of sewing and materials.
And this is woven on my rigid heddle loom. I've got a little loom.
So you wove this piece, you stitched on top of this cloth, and then you painted on top of the cloth?
Yes. Because this is done on a really nice chalky surface of paper, and so I can hand paint with gouache on it. And it actually holds a really nice color relationship, or if it's flat enough, it's hard to tell where the brush strokes begin and end. And when I'm working on them, I'm working either in Photoshop or in by hand afterwards. But I think of Photoshop or post-production, I don't see a division between pre-production and post-production, like pre-camera and post-camera. But the camera, in a sense, for me, usually marks a time where, because my disease is progressive, and it marks a moment in time for me. And I feel that when you have a progressive disease, time becomes more precious in certain ways. And my tremor gets worse as I go on. And so it might be that, like, for example, here, I started this platform when I was very competent. I was painting it, and then I finished it as my tremor got worse. So you can kind of see places where it kind of breaks down, and the platform's over there too.
So this one is also, I mean, I have a feeling that inside this knitted piece is a secret message. But then you have this screen on top, or?
This is done in Photoshop.
Fantastic. I love the way that creates another level, physical distance level.
And because I shot these on plywood backgrounds, I wanted to play with the frames of them. So the frames were wood and the background was wood, and then playing with the Photoshop stripes that are evident on the top of the platforms.
They're very happy pictures. I mean, it's unexpected. You can see through the sculpture, and then you have this wonderful little red line at the top there, which looks like you also painted that one on.
Yes, and then there's a drop shadow done in Photoshop.
That's sneaky.
Yes, and this, well, what happened was that before I got Parkinson's, I was living in the States and I was making all of this work that was labor intensive, but labor intensive in a different way. Like very labor intensive in the way that you could see every mark, kind of like the platforms with the patterns on them. And then what happened was I was going out into the world and documenting disasters and things like that. But then when I got Parkinson's, it kind of happened with, I was teaching at the time and we had to submit goals every year. And I always had all these long lists of all my goals. And then when I got Parkinson's, I just handed in one sentence that said, my new goal is to not have any goals. And I submitted that, and I got the exact same form response from my chair that I had gotten all the other years, so I realized they weren't reading them. And that's when I thought, okay, from now on, I'm going to make work for myself and not for anybody else.
Wow.
I'm going to make work that I love to make and just have fun.
Wow, that was a real
eye-opener.
When was that? What year?
That was in 2010, I think.
Wow. I know you have a lot of followers, a lot of young artists follow you on both sides of the border and admire your work and how complex it is. Recently, I was talking to one of your students at OCAD who said you were such a tough teacher.
Oh.
He graduated last year. And he didn't appreciate you until now that he's graduated and he sees how great your work is and he realizes that what you taught him was so useful. Although at the time he thought you were hard on the students, and but he learned a lot. And I think that's a tribute to you that you know, don't tell your students what they want to hear, but you push them into their own directions.
Right, and one of the things that I do as a teacher is I give them projects, but any project I say, it's just a guideline. And if the project gets in the way of the work you need to accomplish or you need to do, do the work you need to do. Because I feel a lot of times students fall into making work for other people. And I really want them, you know, I was a visiting artist at Sheridan this week, and I told the students, you're all gonna die. We're all gonna die, so you have to do what you love, you know?
It's really true. Tell me about this one, because this one is somewhat different from other things.
Yes,
and,
it is.
And I would like you to talk about that a bit, if you would, please.
So this one, the three dots, they're actually light. I had my student hold up, not my student, she was my student, but she's my assistant. I had her hold a disco ball, and the disco ball reflected onto the surface of this. So because there's so much Photoshop in my work, everyone thinks it's done in Photoshop. But I'm actually getting pretty interested in the dynamics of photography, the way that light can bounce around.
And then this one, you kind of throw everything up in the air and it just falls down. So this, in a way, to me, is the most confusing because I can't figure out where gravity is.
Well, this one, okay, unless I'm shooting on a pattern background, I shoot them on a white background. This one's not, but what I did was I printed it out and then I painted on it.
The painting off here, which is so
interesting. Yes, and then I photographed it, put drop shadows in Photoshop, and some of the brush marks are done in Photoshop. I printed it out again, and I painted into it.
What I think is so interesting about Michelle's work is that there are so many layers and levels. Before she gets to the final product, she has made so many different things. She's made paintings, she's made sculptures, she's made bracelets, she's made wooden structures, and together it becomes a kind of photograph, isn't it? A kind of sculpture, a kind of multimedia piece that is full of emotion and full of
of happiness. And,
when I first started doing them, I thought of them as sculptures, not as photos. And then a friend of mine in Montreal said, I love your new photographs you posted on the website. And I said, they're not photographs, they're sculptures. And then I said, wait a minute, they are kind of photographs. And I got really interested in the photographic document, because a lot of people, like, when you don't see the work in person, how do you know it's a sculpture or a photograph? It's hard to tell the difference.
It's true, it's true.
And I grew up in Victoria, and I was not someone, like, my parents didn't go to museums or anything like that. My father was a marine engineer, and I grew up on a sailboat. And it was beautiful, but you have a lot of people living in one boat, so you have to keep everything totally organized.
And I have to say, having been in Michelle's wonderful apartment and studio, is that it is one of the most delightful places that I have been, with so many different kinds of things.
It's like a needle in a haystack.
But it's perfectly organized. It's not. It's bright. It's organized. The sculpture. There's all the things you're working on. The knitting pieces. The sculptural pieces. And all the parts are there. But as one would expect, everything is beautifully laid out.
Well, interestingly, like the first time that you came to my space and I showed you the photographs, you said, "Where's the sculptures?" So I took you down to my basement, and they were all stacked.
That's right, in the storage facility.
Yes.
One last one, if you would talk about this one. This little one, and then I wondered if people...
Well, maybe we should talk about the glove.
Oh, the glove, okay, over there. Talk about the glove, and then maybe people have questions. You can go in front.
So this glove piece here, I really see as a transitional work between the works with the bundles and the new work, because it was the first time that I put my body in the work. And this is when I first photographed it without a glove, and I just had my hand, and I realized that it didn't work because I have tattoos all over my arm, and you could tell it was me. So I wanted to make a kind of skin for my arm, and also the arm kind of punctuates through the surface, holding this three-dimensional object in front of the painting. And I made this glove myself. It's not easy to make gloves. It took 6 gloves to make this one.
Here's.
And it's sewn into a canvas.
Go right there. Does anyone have a question? From Michelle?
Yeah.
Yes.
I do. You talked a lot about the material and your process, but you haven't talked about pattern, and I'm just fascinated by the way you use pattern.
Yes, that's good, because...
Speak to that.
Yes, pattern for me is something that I use to repeat and repeat, kind of like a body knowledge. So I call it kind of like haptic knowledge, knowing what you can physically do through repeating the action. Like when you have Parkinson's, you think you know how to walk or run or make something, but as it progresses, you think you know how to do it, but your brain does not tell your body how to do things.
Go back and get Michelle.
So when I'm making these patterns, it's almost like I'm learning, or I'm keeping my hand nimble by making these repeated patterns. But also, repeating patterns takes a lot of time because they're all hand painted, and that opens up a lot of thinking time for me. You know, and times when I can't walk or do something really physical, I sit at the table and I can work for hours. Like on these backdrops, you know, they took hours.
So I mean, why? So you, some people call it sculpture, some people call it photography. Why don't you call it painting?
That's interesting, because before I taught at OCAD, I thought of myself as a tried and true painter.
That, I think of you as a painter, but I'm not really sure what you are. So.
Well, I think of myself as a maker, not a painter, because of. It's funny because I need to reassess this, because painting for me, like my work does more than like titillate the eye on or the hand, but at the same time I am using those things in my work quite a bit. I am honoring my hands and I am titillating the eyes through my use of color and pattern. But I guess, you know, I teach at OCAD in the painting and drawing department, and there's so many painters there that are really painterly. And I think of myself as more of a conceptual color layer, I guess.
A true multimedia artist.
Could you talk about this work, which has been bothering me, because I can't imagine physically, by the way, how you do some of these things, but this one is almost macabre with your head or what's represented.
Yes, and it looks like a smile on a decapitated head.
Yeah. I know. Now you just want that out. Yeah. Yeah.
No, this one is really, for me, like, I feel like, well, I've been working on this semi-autobiographical fiction, this book that I've been writing, and it's called Upstairs, which is all for me about being in my head. And so this division between the body and the head for me is also interesting, because I have got deep brain stimulators in my brain that were done at Toronto Western that allow me to move. And I have I'm running on electricity, which I have to, they're on all the time so that I can move. And I have battery packs in my chest and I have to charge them every couple of days. And so I have had brain surgery twice, and you have to be awake for it, which is really terrifying, but they drill right into your head while you're awakening for me. Maybe it is a terrifying picture in some ways.
Wow. So is that, were you thinking about that when you made that picture?
Well, no, because when I think about my work, often I'll think about it afterwards, because these ones of myself, I'm not there taking, I'm not on the other side of the camera, I'm on this side of the camera.
Right.
And so this one I find more terrifying, because it reminds me of that Abbey Gray photograph, the guy with the bag on his head. And so when I saw these two images, I picked those two out to print just because they were so kind of spooky.
May I say one other thing?
Yes, please.
Michelle, can you speak about this hand? Because I think I know what I'm looking at until I get close, and then I realize, oh, all the patterns hand painted, this looks like a watercolor shadow. It looks like watercolor or gouache.
No, when I first started making these pieces, I started they were paintings of pieces of clothing and bundles. And I had started by making like a typical painter would do. And then what happened was, and there's one upstairs that Jane has that's green and it's sitting on a pet painting of what the bundle is. But when I make paintings, for some reason, I pretty much make paintings one to one. And then I set them on the floor. They're called footnotes because I put them on the floor and they have notes inside. And so this is one of those paintings. But then this is a crumpled piece of paper that I decided I'm gonna cut a hole in this painting. And I sewed this glove in and I'm holding this crumpled piece of paper in front of the painting of the, it's actually my ex-husband's, one of his shirts. And at the time I did this, when I started working on clothing, I started doing this series of work called Letters for Kevin. But life changes, and I moved to Toronto, and we got divorced, and I'm not gonna go into that. Because those are one of those things that I like to keep way down.
Anybody else have a question or a comment or something to ask Michelle? Barry, you have?
I'm just admiring all the different textures in this work here.
Yeah, this one's hand painted.
The painting on that is amazing, actually.
This is a weaving. This is a shirt that I sewed. And this is a painting. But then, these are hand painted. You can see them when you come up close. But because they're printed on such delicate paper, anytime I work on top of them, it's a risk.
I come closer, but I disappear into your photograph.
Yeah, I noticed your shirt right
into there.
Barry, we were about to ask you for a donation of your shirt to Michelle's practice. Oh yeah, that's a good one. Look at you. Well, that's a very good one. Do it. Wait a second, Barry. Let's get a picture of the two of you. That's pretty cool.
I'm smiling, you can't tell.
Well, I mean, we're all learning to see what a smile is now behind a mask. It's a whole new story, isn't it?
Thank you. Yeah, this one is one of the older ones because I started doing these plaids. The plaids are earlier, most of them, because they're based on my husband's shirts, my ex-husband's shirts.
I think that's fantastic. I really love, it doesn't matter how many times I hear you speak about your pictures, each time I learn something new.
Because I always add new things.
You always add new things, that's the best part.
Like when I was doing these photographs of the yellow pants, when Nicola was shooting them, I said I want them to look like yellow bell peppers that you cut open. That was my idea first. How to tell her to photograph them.
A yellow bell pepper, does anybody think of that? Michelle, thank you so much for having the show with us. I know that you're a great addition to our city and you are well loved by many artists and many people in the arts community. Thank you for being here with us today.
Thank you.
And stay here every day. We love having you here. Thank you.